السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا وأسوتنا وقائدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه أجمعين وعلى كل من تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. سبحانك اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. وبعد، once again, respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, all praises for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once again, it's an honor, it's a privilege to be here with you. I've been to this masjid, alhamdulillah, thumma alhamdulillah, on more than one occasion. Maybe it's my fourth, fifth, or sixth time, I don't remember, recall. Every time I see new faces, the old faces, I see some of them, but they disappear and then I see new faces, so I think it's a place where people come in and come out, move in, move out. Nevertheless, the title that we have today is to do with, as the brother mentioned, relating to the blessed month of Ramadan al-Mubarak. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, when he would see the crescent of the month of Rajab, he would make a dua. And this is in the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari. When he would see the crescent, the moon of the month of Rajab, which is 2 months before Ramadan, he would make a dua and he would say, Allahumma barik lana fi Rajab, wa barik lana fi Sha'ban, wa balighna ila Ramadan. O Allah, bless us in our Rajab. This is when the month of Rajab has arrived. He would make a dua. He would say, O Allah, place blessings in our Rajab. Make it full of blessings for us. And then make the month subsequent to Rajab, the month of Sha'ban, make that also full of blessings. And make us reach, balighna, make us reach the month of Ramadan. Now this is quite significant. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam is actually anticipating the blessed month of Ramadan in 2 months in advance. He's waiting, he's eager, he's showing his eagerness for the month of Ramadan. He's waiting, Ramadan cannot come to him. You know, he is waiting and anticipating for the month of Ramadan. So this in itself is a reminder for us. There's a lesson in this for us, that we should anticipate the month of Ramadan. We should make dua. We are in the month of Sha'ban right now. We have just over 10 days left for the month of Ramadan. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would anticipate 2 months in advance. And he would make dua for Rajab to be full of blessings. He would make dua for Sha'ban to be full of blessings. And he would ask Allah to give him life and to make him stay alive, that he reaches the month of Ramadan so that he can worship Allah and gain the blessings and rewards of the month of Ramadan. This is anticipation, eagerness to want Ramadan, anticipating the month of Ramadan, wanting Ramadan to come quickly. And this is something very important, because some of us, unfortunately, brothers and sisters, you know, especially now Ramadan is in the summer months, sometimes subconsciously we don't realize. We think, you know, this year some of us, we sit down and when we discuss about Ramadan, the only thing we talk about is, oh, this year Ramadan, the fasts are going to be too long, 18 hours, 19 hours, so long, nights are small, Taraweeh is going to be so difficult. That's actually wrong. It's actually reprehensible. It's actually disrespectful. Allah is, you know, we should value the month of Ramadan. It's full of blessings, it's a gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. And we should show anticipation that if not, that at least we should not be negative towards the month of Ramadan. That is so difficult, hardship. Okay, we can talk about that this year, maybe in a very subtle way, that this year the month of Ramadan, the fasts are going to be long and lengthy than previous years. But to discuss and to complain and to think that it's going to be so difficult this year to fast and this and that, that's actually kufran, a ni'am. This is showing ingratitude to the gift of Allah, ingratitude towards the blessed month of Ramadan that Allah is blessing us with. And this is something we really need to take out from our conversations. We should remember, we should think that it's nothing. 18, 19 hours is nothing. We do not even experience a percentage of the hardships and the difficulty that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam and the companions underwent in their lives, not even a percentage. They strived, they struggled, they gave their lives for Islam. And we have a month of Ramadan that we find it difficult to fast for 17 hours, 16 hours, 18 hours, and a fast that we will open with samosas and pastries and rice and chicken and beef and burgers and whatever. We will be eating a lot of different types of good food. And even in suhoor we'll be eating. And we eat a lot, pizzas and all the different types of foods. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, when they would fast, I remember in the beginning of Islam, fasting was continuous. Even at the night you could not eat. And then that was abrogated. And then the rule was that intimacy with one spouse in the night of Ramadan, that was prohibited, but you can eat. And then Allah allowed that as well. And He said, فَالْآنَ بَاشِرُهُنَّ وَابْتَغُوا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. But anyway, the point is that we do not experience even a percentage of the difficulty, the hardship, the sacrifice that the Blessed Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions underwent. And we don't even experience the sacrifice, the trouble that people in other parts of the world have to undergo, not just in the month of Ramadan, but daily. And this is actually what I want to talk about. There's actually, you know, the fasting, and there are many, many rewards for fasting. As you know, there are many hadith, and we hear about these things anyway, so I don't really want to go into those hadiths that talk about fasting. Many hadith, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever observes the fast of Ramadan, إيمانا واحتسابا, with full conviction, with iman and belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, واحتسابا, and hoping for reward from Allah, غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. All his previous sins are forgiven. من قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا, whoever stands up in the middle of the night, at night, whoever worships Allah, قيام الليل, تهجد صلاة, إيمان واحتسابا, غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. His previous sins are forgiven. And you have many other hadith that talk about the blessings of Ramadan and the fast in the month of Ramadan. Like there's a hadith where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, كل عمل ابن آدم له. Every good action the human being, Ibn Adam, the son of Adam, does, Ibn Adam, كل عمل ابن آدم له. It is for him. The rewards are for him. الحسنات بعشر أمثالها. Every deed you do, the rewards are multiplied 10 times. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِلَّا الصَّوْمِ قَالَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ إِلَّا الصَّوْمِ. He says, Allah says, except fasting. Everything you get a reward and it's multiplied by 10. It's in the Quran. مَنْ جَاءَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ فَلَهُ عَشْرُ أَمْثَالِهَا. You do one good deed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His infinite mercy, blesses us and gives us 10 rewards. Tenfold, the rewards are increased. إلا الصوم, except for fasting. Allah says, فَإِنَّهُ لِي وَأَنَا أَجْزِي بِهِ. This is a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari and elsewhere. فَإِنَّهُ لِي وَأَنَا أَجْزِي بِهِ. Fasting is not for him, and it's not that it will be multiplied 10 times. Fast is something that's only solely for me, Allah says. And I shall reward him, which does not mean that someone else will reward for other actions. The meaning here is that the reward here, the promise for other good actions, is that they are increased and multiplied tenfold. But for fast, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is for me and I will reward him as much as I want. There is no end, because fasting is full of sabr, patience, Fasting is full of sabr, and innama yuwaffa sabiruna ajrahum bighayri hisab. Those who exercise sabr and patience, they get reward, which is, there's no end to the reward. But anyway, there are many hadiths, but going back to what I was talking about, is that we need to realize that we do not undergo or experience even a percentage of the hardship that the early people went through, and even Muslims today in different parts of the world. And this is actually one of the salient lessons that is given. You know, there are many objectives, many maqasid, many objectives of fasting. And there are many reasons why you fast. And there are many lessons. Allah says in the Quran, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامِ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Fast so that you acquire in your life taqwa, God consciousness. So there are many lessons, but one very important lesson that is given in fasting is what? Is that when we remain hungry, when we undergo hardship and difficulty, 18 hours, 16 hours, 15 hours, it makes us think about those people who are not as fortunate as us. It makes us think about the poor people, the impoverished people. It makes us for a moment, it's just 1 month reminding us that there are people in this world who spend all their lives like this. Not just 1 month. And that's also difficult for us. We cannot tolerate it. And we complain 18 hours, 17 hours. There are people who stay hungry for 24 hours, 30 hours. The time of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they would survive on water and dates. What we call aswadain, aswadan. And that's why it's actually some of the scholars, they encourage some of the students and encourage us as well that every so often in our life we should spend 24 hours or 48 hours or a week only on dates and water. Just to see how he feels. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba companions, they spent days on dates and water. That's it. I think we should do that sometimes. Outside of Ramadan, spend 1 week in your house today. This week is the date and aswadain week. 1 whole week. No food. No tea, nothing. Maybe just if somebody has, they need tea, or maybe just have tea, that's it. Yeah, it's intoxicant, which you shouldn't really have, but I mean, I do have it as well, don't worry about it. But at least, you know, not eat food. Just have a lot of dates all over your house and water, Zamzam water. Spend a whole week, if not 4 days, 3 days, at least 24 hours or 48 hours. This fasting, This is the message or the lesson that has been given to us. To think about the less fortunate people. Think about those people who are not as fortunate as us. People who are struggling in their daily life. The poor people. And this is why the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith of Sahih al-Bukhari, كَانَ أَجْوَدَ النَّاسِ. He was the most generous of individuals. And then the hadith says, وَكَانَ أَجْوَدَ مَا يَكُونُ فِي رَمَضَانِ. He became more generous in the month of Ramadan. The most generous he was in the month of Ramadan. He was generally very generous, but his generosity would increase in the month of Ramadan. فَكَانَ أَجْوَدْ بِالْخَيْرِ مِنَ الْرِيحَ الْمُرْسَلَةِ. He was more generous than blowing wind. This is a hadith in the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari. Why was he more generous? The ulama, actually, the commentators look into the details and they explain, they say, there's many reasons, and one reason is that لِشَرَفِ الزَّمَانِ, because the time, the month of Ramadan is full of blessings, because the sanctity of the time, because every good deed, obligatory or optional rewards are increased, as we know. So therefore, giving in charity, being more charitable in the month of Ramadan, the rewards are increased. And there's a hadith in Sunan of Imam al-Tirmidhi where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, O Messenger of Allah, أَيُّ الصَّدَقَةِ أَفْضَلُ. Which charity, which form of charity is the most virtuous? He said, صَدَقَةٌ فِي رَمَضَانِ. Charity in the month of Ramadan is the most virtuous type of charity. So because of the time, because rewards are increased. And then also, another reason is that because he is helping. When we are charitable in the month of Ramadan, we are charitable in the month of Ramadan, we are helping, we are assisting the fasting people. The qa'imeen, the sa'imeen, the dhakireen, the musalleen, the people who are involved in the worship of Allah. We are helping them. Man fattara sa'iman, the hadith, man fattara sa'iman, falahu mithlu ajrihi. Whoever helps or opens, helps open a fast for someone, whoever provides iftar for another Muslim, فله أجر مثل أجره. فله مثل أجره. He has same amount of reward. That, and then the question might come that does that mean that his reward is decreased? No. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من غير أن ينقص من أجر الصائم شيء. Nothing is decreased from the rewards of the fasting person. But the other person who provided iftar will get the reward, similar reward. So just imagine if we are fasting and we offer iftar and we provide iftar for a fellow Muslim brother or a sister. In one day, rather than gaining and obtaining and acquiring the rewards of one fast, two fasts. If we do that every single day in the month of Ramadan, rather than having rewards of 30 fasts, we'll end up having rewards of 60 fasts. Only one person does. Every day you just feed one person in the month of Ramadan. You say, okay, iftar is provided by me. One, every day in the month of Ramadan, one person, you'll end up 60 fasts, not 30. So this is fasting is teaching us this lesson. Always thinking about others. Always preferring other people. And this is actually an amazing quality. And this is, I want to just briefly talk about this quality. But brothers, this is, and sisters, this attribute or this quality, this characteristic of giving preference to others. In Arabic, it's called ithar. This is one of the lessons that fasting is teaching us. Ithar. Pick up the Quran and pick up the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have numerous texts that talk about ithar. It's actually an amazing quality, ithar. Athara yuthiru itharan. It's an amazing quality. It's a topic on its own that we can talk about, but I've just related it to fasting because fast and Ramadan teaches us charity, teaches us ithar. Always thinking about others. Being selfless, not being selfish. You see, the opposite of ithar is selfishness. Being self-centered, which is a severely blameworthy character trait that a Muslim and even a human being can have. Being selfish. Only I matter, myself matters, my interest matters, that's it, nothing else. It's only about me, about my money, my job, my house, my family, that's it, my benefits, my interest. I don't care what happens in the world, I don't care what happens to anyone, as long as I have a nice house, a nice property, nice car, I have a good, peaceful life. In the masjid, people can be, other Muslims can be, whatever, people can be in any difficult situation. It doesn't really concern me. That's selfishness. That's being selfish, that's being self-centered, and that's a severely blameworthy character trait. It's a very bad attribute and quality to possess. Islam says we should obtain, we should inculcate, we should instill in our hearts and in our minds and in our lives the quality of ithar, giving preference to others. And this is based on a famous hadith of Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. This is what we call qa'ida kulliya. This is a principle, an accepted principle in Islam. لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. SubhanAllah, look at the words, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, you cannot be a believer. لا يؤمن أحدكم. You cannot even be called a complete believer. We want to know who a believer is. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa is giving us the definition. You cannot, a person cannot be a complete believer until he does not love for his fellow Muslim brother, لأخيه, and also sister included in this, ما يحب لنفسه, what he likes for his own self, cannot be a complete believer. Here in this hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he say? You cannot be a complete believer until you don't like for your لأخيه, for your brother. Right? For your brother, what you like for yourself. Now, even though, some people might disagree with this, but even though we can include in this li'akhihi, yeah? Listen to this attentively because some people get heated about a lot of different things. Even though, you may want to disagree, but even though we can include in li'akhihi a non-Muslim, someone who's a non-Muslim, he's your brother in humanity. I actually once said this in a talk based on another hadith. And somebody, one youngster, was out of rage and said, how can you call a non-Muslim your brother? I said, look, what I mean by that is that, do you have a nose? I said, yes. Does he have a nose? Yes. Do you have 2 ears? Yes. Does he have 2 ears? Yes. Do you have a mouth? Yes. Is he the son of Adam? Yes. Are you the son of Adam? Yes. That's it. He's just a human being. He's not an animal. He's a human being. That's what I mean. And actually the ulama, the commentators of hadith, you know in the hadith when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that a Muslim is the one from whose hands and actions his brother, or not that hadith, but somewhere else, when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned, yeah, in this hadith, you cannot be a complete believer until you don't like for your brother. Some of the early scholars, like Imam al-Nawawi and others, they said, هذا يشمل عموم الأخوة. This includes general brotherhood, Muslim as well as non-Muslim. And he said, just like you want hidayah and guidance for yourself, يحب لأخيه الكافر الهداية كما يحب لنفسه الهداية. Just like you like for your own self hidayah and guidance, you want your non-Muslim brother in humanity to have guidance. You want him to enter Jannah, just like you want to enter paradise and have eternal bliss. So anyway, even though we can include in this hadith, you cannot be a complete believer until you don't like for your brother, even non-Muslims here, but if somebody doesn't want to, there's another hadith in Musnad Ahmad, which is quite significant, in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا يبلغ العبد حقيقة الإيمان. A slave will not obtain the reality of faith. Here in the first hadith of Sahih Muslim, he said, you cannot be a believer. He said, here in this hadith, لا يبلغ العبد. A slave will not obtain, will not acquire حقيقة الإيمان, the reality of faith. حتى يحب للناس ما يحب لنفسه. Until he doesn't like for humanity. The word للناس here changed. Quite significant. The way you don't like for humanity, what you like for yourself, you cannot attain the reality of faith. In another hadith, he said, أحب. Somebody came to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم and said, O Messenger of Allah, how can I enter paradise? He said, أحب لنفسك ما تحب, أحب لأخيك ما تحب لنفسك. وَكْرَهْ لِنَفْسِكَ مَا تُحِبَّ لِأَخِيكَ. Like for yourself what you like for your brother. Or like for your brother what you like for yourself, and dislike for your brother what you dislike for yourself. This is a قَاعِدَ كُلِّيَّة. It's a well-accepted principle. Brothers and sisters, we know about this, but subhanAllah, you know, in our lives we do not, or some of us don't. We do not appreciate this principle, this قَاعِدَة. We don't practice it. We don't see it in our daily lives. We don't see it in every relationship that we find ourselves in. I'll give you a few scenarios. In every relationship that we find ourselves in this world, right? This qa'ida, this principle, this lesson, and this approach, we must have it in our lives. Every relationship, parents-children relationship, what happens? Parents, when they are parents, they only think about their rights. Some parents, the only ayat and verse of the Quran they know is وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. They probably don't even know where it's in the Quran, but they know it's somewhere there. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. You know, you have to, Allah has mentioned it with tawheed. وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا فَلَا تَقُل لَّهُمَا أُفٍّ. They know the word. Don't even say, you know, when the child, oof. It's a verse of the Quran. وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. But the only thing they think about, see, what Islam is telling us here, brothers and sisters, is that sometimes, and not sometimes, every time in our dealings with others, we need to put ourselves in the shoes of the others. When we are dealing with anybody, for one moment, think, close your eyes, let me go on that side and let him come on this side. For one moment, go on the other side of the fence. For one moment, and then deal. When you're talking to your wife, your husband, your father, your daughter, your son, your business partner, whoever, one moment, reverse the roles. This is what ithar is. This is what the quality is. Parents, they don't think about what it feels to be a child. They were children a while ago, but they forgot. You tell them, think about it. That you were a child, remember when you wanted to get married as well, and you didn't want to get forced. Did you want to get forced? Probably the father's marriage was, he himself went through love marriage, baby. I'm not saying it's allowed, whatever, before marriage, it's all haram, don't worry. But I'm just saying, try to be easy. Try to be easy and try to be understanding with your children. You know, for one moment, go on the other side and say, look, you are living in 2010 in this day and age in the West, and in England you're living, and how would you want your father to treat you? For one moment, but we don't realize. We forget how it feels to be a child. We forget. And the opposite as well. That's the son, the daughter, they forget. Well, they don't forget because they've never been parents, but they don't realize. They need to realize for a moment that, look, I am 21, 22 right now. Or maybe they have young children, 1 year of age, 2 years. Today you've been disrespectful to your father, to your mother. Today you've, you know, just stormed out of the house with your baby in your hand. This child baby in your hand, one day will storm out from your house with his baby. This is what happens, you know, they say kama tudinu tudan in Arabic. Whatever, like you treat others, you'll be treated. This is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this life. You know, there's an incident mentioned, there's not time, but there's an incident mentioned, I don't know how, it's one of the books, I don't know how true it is or not, whatever, I don't know the authenticity, but it's mentioned in one of the books, that this person used to, you know, there was this, in generation after generation, they had this tradition of what? When the father used to get old, they used to go on top of a mountain cliff, and, you know, when it's no longer, they cannot look after their fathers, the son used to, you know, push the father off the cliff so that he dies. For generations, this kept on happening. Generation after generation, so one such son took his father in his 80s, okay, taking up, and when he was just putting him on the edge of the cliff, the father started laughing and smiling. So the son said, look, you know, you should be crying or you should be sad. Why are you laughing? Why are you smiling? He said, I just remember exactly on the same spot, not even there, in the same spot. Good, you know, I don't know how many years ago, I did the same thing to my father. I'm just thinking, exactly on the same spot. I wasn't even there. It's exactly, I can remember this area. Exactly on the same spot, this is where what happened. I shoved my father off the cliff and down he went and he died. And today it's the same thing. So, but when he was having this conversation, this son, suddenly something happened to him and he had remorse and he realized that. You know, it's exactly the same. My son will say the same thing to me. He said, come back, you know, I just feel guilty. And they say that from that day onward, this whole tradition in the generation stopped. Because no, they stopped after that. Kama tudinu tudan, how we treat our parents, our children will treat us. We forget, we need to always go on the other side of the fence. This is ithaq. Husband-wife relationship, for one moment. Let the wife think to herself that, let me be on the other side. It's difficult to be a husband. He's going out, he's working, he's struggling, he's striving, he's earning the money, he's doing this, he's running around, he's putting in the effort. Look, I'm speaking to him in a disrespectful manner. Would I want somebody to talk to me like this? No. So don't speak to your husband like that. And likewise, a husband. The problem is that we always, the problem is that whenever we have talks in marriage, the couples come, I tell them, I say, look, when couples come, husbands don't come to learn about your rights. Come to learn about what you owe to your wives, responsibilities. Wives do not come to learn about your rights. Everybody's asking, phoning, emailing, sheikh, this, that, you know, what are my rights? I said, no, don't learn about your rights. You don't need to learn about your rights. If we all learn what we have to give others, all the problems in the world will be solved. Don't learn about what we have, what we owe, what others owe us, but what we owe others. There's a story mentioned, and this person used to, this guy, he used to, when he used to go to people's houses, he was quite greedy, so they mention this about him in some of the old books, that whenever he used to go to someone's house to visit, he would knock on the door and then straight away sniff. What have you cooked? What's cooking in the kitchen? What's on the stove? What have you cooked? Nice smell. You know, he wants to eat. And when someone used to come to his house, open the door straight away, he looked at hands. Have you bought something for food? What have you bought to feed me? Which means that there's no giving, it's always taking. When you visit someone's house, you want to eat. When someone comes to your house, you want to eat as well. This is the example of someone who's always me, myself, I, my interest matters, nothing else matters. The interest of the other individual does not matter to him. So this is even in the relationship of marriage, husbands and wife, we have this oldest problems, you know, the mother-in-law, daughter-in-law. It can get solved for one moment. The mother-in-law, she's a mother-in-law. Remember, put yourself for one moment on the other side of the fence. wear the shoes of your daughter-in-law. You were a daughter-in-law 34 years ago. Do you remember? You should know how it feels to be a daughter-in-law. Yeah, you tell the mother-in-law, you should know how it feels to be a daughter-in-law. She'll say, daughter-in-law, probably that was in pre-existence or something. She doesn't even remember now what it feels to be like a daughter-in-law. Because this is a problem. When you're a daughter-in-law, the only thing that matters to you is all the rights of the daughter-in-law. When you become a mother-in-law, you forget everything about you. You think that in the world there's no daughter-in-laws that exist, and only mother-in-laws exist in the world. When you're a father, you only think only parents exist, children don't exist. When you're a child, that's the only person that exists in the world is a child. So that's what happens. You tell the mother-in-law, remember, you are young, you are a bride, you got married 21, 22, 25, 27, you are young, you had a small child. How did you want to be treated? You didn't want people to be harsh, your mother-in-law to be harsh with you. You wanted a bit of rest, you wanted to be treated well. Now you have a young daughter-in-law in your house, treat her in the best of ways for one moment. Just think, close your eyes, how do you want to be treated? Put yourself on her place, on the other side of the fence. And the daughter-in-law as well, remember that one day you will become a mother-in-law. Right now you have a 2-year-old son, 3-year-old, 4-year-old, 5-year-old son. This son will grow up, will go college, university, whatever, and he'll get married, and then we'll bring a bride in the house as well. Remember, you'll become one day in 25 years from today, you will, unless you die, but you know, normally you will get that life. And if you do get that life, then you will become a what? A mother-in-law. Then what? How do you want your daughter-in-law to treat you? Do you want her to give you, you know, all the slandering and swearing and being disrespectful and things like that, and talking to you in a harsh way and complaining about you all the time? And you don't want to be treated like that, do you? By your own beloved son. Remember, this is your son that you're bringing up and your son's wife. It's difficult for a mother. So think like that. Every relationship, even the relationship we have, you know, in the community, the landlord and the tenant, major problems that occur in the community. Landlord lives in the landlord world, tenant lives in the tenant world. For the landlord, there's no such a thing as a tenant. For the tenant, there's no such a thing as a landlord. Landlord, for one moment. This is ether. Think for one moment. For one moment, think. If you were a tenant, wouldn't you want your house to be in a condition that you can exist in and live in? Wouldn't you want your landlord to come and look after the house and give you and provide you all the facilities? You don't want your landlord to be harsh. And you're not well, you know, off enough to purchase a property. Wouldn't you want it to be like that? Yes, you would. So now treat your tenant. Mujar or mustajar. Treat your tenant with respect, with courtesy. Be kind, be considerate. Think about his interests. And likewise, the landlord, the tenant. The tenant, yeah, I want this done, I want this done, I want that done, this is not done, and this is the windows, and there's air coming out from there, and this and that. And then not paying the rent on time. For one moment, think, if you were a landlord, and remember, imagine to yourself, close your eyes for a moment, and think, if I was a landlord, I only had one property, I had bills to pay, life was tough, difficult, and the only income that I had, or one of the only incomes that I had, was through this rental property that I've given. And the tenant in there, neither does he leave and vacate the property, and neither does he give me any rent on time. How would you feel? You've got children to look after. Think, and then think, okay, yes. If I was there, that's how I would want my rent to be paid on time. So pay your rent on time as well. The employer and the employee, same qaida, principle. The employer and the employee. The employee always thinks about hadith like أَعْتُ الْأَجِيرَ أَجْرَهُ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَجِفَ عِرْقَ. There's a hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Give the wages of your employee, the worker. Give his wages before his sweat dries. Give it on time. But he doesn't think for a moment whether he has some sweat or not. He hasn't thought about that. He knows all his rights. Treat your employee well, properly. You know, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, أَعْتُ الْأَجِيرَ أَجْرَهُ قَبْلَ يَجِفْ عِرْقَ. But think for a moment, if you were an employer, how would you want to be treated? You have to think for a moment. And this is why, you know, This is the qaida, the principle of always thinking about the other side. Always thinking about the other side. The manager of a business, the boss of a business, needs to think for a moment. If you were working for someone, if you were employed, how would you want to be treated by your manager, by your boss? If the way you want to be treated, the way you like to be treated, treat your staff and the ones working for you in that manner as well. The people earlier on, people go on strike. People go on strike. Very easy to go on strike. Very quickly, you know, anything, any problem, strike. You know, in the early times, some of our salaf, the salihin, the pious, righteous individuals, they would give wages back at the end of the month because they felt that they never worked diligently. You had 8 hours work and you used your own mobile phone and carrying chatting away, or you had internet and you're going onto your own website and doing your own personal work. Do you really have permission to do that or not? They would go and pay back. They were teachers. And shuyukh and ulama who would teach, at the end of the month, they would think that, you know what, I probably was neglectful in my time here and there, 5 minutes. Like there was one sheikh who would teach his students, who would get his wages at the end of the month. And what he would do is, if somebody would come and talk to him about his personal life, he would, notes down. I spoke to somebody for 5 minutes, 3 minutes, 4 minutes. At the end, he would calculate the whole thing and go and pay the money back. This is, you know, accounting, being accountable. Unless you have permission, that's a different, you know, case altogether. Buying and selling as well. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. Rahimallahu imra'an samhan idha ba'a, samhan idha ishtara, samhan idha qtada. Allah have mercy on the man who is considerate, samhan, from musamaha. He is gentle, he is what? Considerate, he is kind. When he buys and when he is considerate when he sells. When you're a buyer, when you're a mushtari and a buyer. Idha ba'a, idha ishtara. When you're buying and when you're selling. When you're buying something as a customer, you go to the shop or you're doing business with another company and you're purchasing something, for one moment, put yourself in their shoes. If you go to the shop for one moment, put yourself in their shoes. And if you're a seller, as a shopkeeper, you're selling something, then for one moment, put yourself in the shoes of the customer. This is actually in the Quran. وَيْلٌ لِلْمُطَفِّفِينَ, the famous verse of the Quran, Surah. This Surah, you know, we read the Quran, we should think and ponder about the Quran, brothers and sisters. وَيْلٌ لِلْمُطَفِّفِينَ, destruction be unto the people of تَطْفِيف, الْمُطَفِّفِينَ. الْمُطَفِّفُونَ, لَمْ, makes it لِلْمُطَفِّفِينَ. Who are these people of Tatfif? Allah says, Wail. Wail means destruction to them. And some ulama said, Wailul wadin fi jahannam. It's a valley in hellfire. May Allah save us. Destruction unto the people of Tatfif. Who are the people of Tatfif? الَّذِينَ إِذَا كَتَالُوا عَلَى النَّاسِ يَسْتَوْفُونَ. These people, when they, إِذَا كَتَالُوا عَلَى النَّاسِ, when they have to receive items through measurement, they yastawfoon. The word yastawfoon is istifa, which means they ensure that they receive every grade. You know when you buy the meter? Brother, it's on. It needs to go exactly on 8. Exactly. It's not on 8. Exactly. Every grade, every ounce, when it's their time to take, idha katalu, that's not a problem. Okay? If you're giving your rights as well, idha katalu ala nasi yastawfoon. But Allah says, wa idha kaluhum. But when it's their time to give others through measurement and others through weight, they give less. When it's their time to give change, they might give a penny less. But when it's their time to take money, they ensure, come, wait, brother. 37 pence, okay, problem. We're not willing to show this courtesy to others, but want others to show courtesy to us. وَإِذَا كَالُوهُمْ أَوَّزَلُوهُمْ يُخْسِرُونَ. Then Allah says, look at the verses. Allah says, أَلَا يَظُنُّ أُولَٰئِكَ أَنَّهُمْ مُبْعُوثُونَ. Don't these people realize? يَظُنُّ. Don't they think? Don't they know? Don't they reflect and realize? أَنَّهُمْ مُبْعُوثُونَ. That they will be resurrected one day. يَوْمَ يَقُومُ النَّاسُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. When the whole of humanity and mankind will have to what? Will have to account, give حساب before رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. These are important verses, brothers and sisters. Every relationship that we find ourselves in, I said, parents, children, spouses, siblings, brothers and sisters, employer employee, landlord tenant, buyer seller, every relationship, even you know, fellow Muslims, giving preference. You're driving a car and you know there's another car arriving or coming from the front. If you give preference to them and you flash your lights and say you go, that's giving preference. I know time, life is very busy and people don't like to, you know, people just don't care about anyone. No courtesy. We live in a world, courtesy is gone, vanished. You know, this once brother came to me, and this is a Muslim brother. We don't even realize, you know, subhanAllah, the problem is that these issues we don't even realize. We don't even think sometimes it's part of Islam. We don't even realize. That's why these issues are far more important. We always hear the fast and this and Ramadan blessings and this and that. We know about all these issues. We know how much reward there is in worshipping Allah. We know about these things, but these things, this one brother came to me and he said, and he was speaking to me and he was boasting. He was feeling so good about himself. I was thinking to myself, A'udhu billah thumma a'udhu billah. I can't tell him right now because there's not a time to tell him, but then later on I spoke to him. This is actually one of the ways of doing that, is not to tell someone in the midst of their, you know, right at that time when they're talking about it, because then they feel bad and they feel embarrassed, etc., etc. But he came to me and said, you know, just the other day or yesterday, I was, you know, in Leicester, we have some of the streets very congested. Yeah, we have some parts which are good, but there's one area, Highfields, they're very congested. I don't know why they don't, they've made a lot of them one-way roads, but a lot of them, you know, cars are parked on both sides. It's just very difficult. I always avoid it. And it's the heartbeat of the Asian Muslims, and mostly the old Indian Gujarati Muslims. And you can smell it from far, far away, you know, before you come to the area. I don't, by the way, I don't live in that area. I moved away a long time ago from the area. But it's the heart. Sometimes we don't realize. This is, again, we don't think. Ramadan comes, we think we're the only ones fasting. Everything, the whole world is fasting. But our non-Muslim neighbors who are not fasting, we should not do something that harms them. If we're fasting, it's us fasting. Think, if you are a non-Muslim, a'udhu billah thumma a'udhu billah, and you know, definitely not, don't think like that. But think that if you were a neighbor, someone who wasn't fasting, and he had to go, he doesn't know the importance of fasting. Right? Would you want to be disturbed? Or think like this, that look, you're a Muslim. Yeah, I think there's a better way to think. The other one, you know, cancellation. But think like this, that look, you were sleeping, and it was not your Ramadan, the Hindus or the Sikhs, they were celebrating something, right? They've got their Diwali or something, right? And they're jumping up and down and making noises until 2, 3 in the morning, and you have to go to a business meeting at 7 o'clock a.m. You have to wake up 6 a.m. You have to go to your surgery. You're a doctor. And they're just troubling you, they're not letting you sleep, your children can't sleep. How would you feel? You wouldn't want to be disturbed. It's their religion, they're doing it, you don't want to be disturbed. Likewise, we have a duty as Muslims. We come to the masjid, Qiyamul Layl, we offer Taraweeh. We should make sure we do not do anything that contributes to harming other people. And the Messenger of Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam actually said this in the hadith. Man, you know, he said, Man akala min hadhihi shayratin mumtinat. فَلَيَقْرَبَنَّ مُصَلَّانَا مَنْ أَكَلَ الْبَصَلَ وَالثُّومَ. Whoever eats onion, garlic, should not even come close to our masjid. Should not even come close to our masjid. He said, وَلْيَقْعُدْ فِي بَيْتِهِ. Let him sit at home. Now one, and that's why the ulama, they state, that in order to do an act of ibadah, if that entails, if that results in harming someone else, you would actually not harm someone, then actually do the act of ibadah. Offering Taraweeh at home is far better than coming to the masjid, standing in the first saf, but harming 2-3 people on the way, or parking your car in a way that it's harming someone. Anyone, Muslim or non-Muslim. You've parked your car where it's blocked an ambulance entrance. There was once somebody blocked an ambulance entrance, and then they announced it in the masjid, and their brother was in the first saf. Someone could die because of the way you park. Some Muslims actually think, you know, we're doing a favor on Allah. It doesn't matter wherever, however we park. We're coming to worship Allah. It doesn't matter. And some people think like that. They come for Friday prayers and they just park anywhere and everywhere. We have a, you know, we have a few Muslim traffic wardens in Leicester. One of them is actually my student. He actually studied, you know, Islamic studies as well. And then he's also a traffic warden. So he asked me this question. He said, you know, some of these Muslims, is it haram for me to give tickets? You know, people come for, they park in an unlawful way, in an unlawful, illegal manner, right? Outside, and they come in for, and I put a few tickets, and they say to me that, you know, we come to offer salah in the masjid, is it bad? You know, I said, no, give two tickets. No, not two tickets, just one. But you should give tickets. Park somewhere else. It doesn't mean that you're doing a favor on Allah. That's we worship Allah. You know, we are offering salah, so that's it. We can park in any way. We're harming. Remember, the issue here is harming people. Because most of these restricted areas are because of the fact that they harm us. It's not about whatever, it's just the legislation. It's about harming. You're blocking. You know, if you're parking in a corner, people cannot turn into the road easily. You're harming people. You're slowing down traffic. And people are being harmed. And that's the whole reason behind this. So I was saying, this brother who came to me, and I'm going to conclude very soon. This brother who came to me, he was feeling, you know, quite boastful and happy. He said, the other day, you know, this Highfield Street is so, the street is so congested and tight. He said, I was driving my car from here, and the other guy, he was coming from, there was another Muslim. You won't find anyone in that area except Muslims. فَمَا وَجَدْنَا فِيهَا غَيْرَ بَيْتٍ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. You know, in the Quran Allah says, فَمَا وَجَدْنَا فِيهَا غَيْرَ بَيْتٍ مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. You know, you won't find any other house besides Muslims. Here is فَمَا وَجَدْنَا فِيهَا غَيْرَ بَيْتٍ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. So, you won't find no non-Muslims. A Muslim, he said, he was coming down from the other side of the road, and I'm driving. And that's it. He stopped and I stopped. So I flashed, I said to him, you go back. He said to me, no, you go back. He said, look, you go back. Then I turned around and said, look, I have to go all the way. He said, no. He said, look, I've got more, so let's measure it. And they sat there arguing. And he was really, he said, you wouldn't just go. He said, you know what I did? You know, look at me. I said, he didn't even want to turn back. You know, I had much more to go. Turn, go all the way back to the end of the road and take. He had less, you know, area to cover. So what I did, I said to my son, you know, Beta, I said, you know what I'll do? Switch off the engine. They're sitting here. Let's see what you're going to do now. And he's really happy about all of this. He's a person who actually, you know, he's actually got a beard and, you know, hat and everything. And he's, you know, externally he's praising Salah and everything. He didn't even realize that this is a sin. And he said, I switched off the engine. Because the other brother, he said, just switched off the engine, took a cigarette out and he put his feet on the dashboard. And he said, okay, what are you going to do? It's just the ego. It's just the ego. You could just go back and save, you know, your time, 5 minutes and take, go back. What's happened? Nothing's happened. You've gone back, so what? Who cares? You've got a reward for the sake of Allah. This is ithar. And he's like, what we did was, he wasn't moving as well. So he said, we live two streets away. I said to my son, when he did that, he said, okay, we just came out of the car. We said, we switched off the car. We said, we're going. Our house is just there. We're just walking. And they walked and they went away to the house. And I don't know what he said after that week, where they came back with the other person. Oh, I think the other person said, okay, I'm going to go now. And then they came back or something like that. But Muslims do things like, this is selfishness, being self-centered. Only I, myself, matter. Ramadan fasting, the main lesson, one of the main lessons that is being taught to us in this blessed month of Ramadan is ithar. It's actually in one of the hadith in Sahih ibn Khuzaymah, the famous long hadith around the time, as some of the books you have here. There's a famous hadith of Salman al-Farsi, radiallahu anhu. In it, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, هُوَ شَهْرُ الْمُوَاسَاتِ. It's a month of sympathy. It's a month of thinking about others, sympathizing with other people. Especially, and not just this month, but our whole lives, always thinking about other people, giving preference. And finally, I would end on this. One thing is very important in this month of Ramadan. We ensure, we do whatever we can do, but we should ensure we do not commit any sins. Most important. And sins to do with the tongue. Sins like what I'm talking about, harming other people. Hurting other people's feelings, at least 1 month. Backbiting, which means you're harming other people. The famous hadith in the Musnad of Imam Ahmed in the time of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, you know, the hadith is that there were two women. This is a sound hadith. This is not made up. Some people think it's fiction. This is a fact. It's a story. It's hadith, sahih, authenticated. In the Musnad, Imam Ahmed has mentioned this in his Al-Musnad. Two women in the time of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were fasting. And they struggled while they were fasting. They could not tolerate fasting. كَادَتَ أَن تَمُوتَ. It was very close that they would die out of hunger and thirst. So somebody came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "Oh Messenger of Allah, is there any rukhsa for them to break their fast?" He called them and he told them to vomit, and they vomited. قَاءَتَ. The hadith says, قَاءَتَ مِلْءَ قَدْحٍ. a utensil, a glass full of, or a utensil full of vomit, vomiting, ما ملء قدح لحما ودما وصديدا. Flesh, blood, and pus came out. Literally, it came out from the mouth. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, these two women, what did they do? صَامَتَ عَمَّا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ لَهُمَا. They observed a fast. They stayed away from those things that Allah made lawful for them. Normally, water is halal. Water, halal food, we eat and drink, it's halal. Well, they stayed away, they fasted. If some, this is an example of somebody who does not abstain from sins. He's staying away from the halal. Those things that Allah has made halal, they were halal before Ramadan, they'll be halal after Ramadan. Even in the month of Ramadan, after Maghrib till Suhoor, they're halal. Right? So it doesn't make sense if someone stays away from the halal, those things which are normally halal, but only for a small period of time, they have been made prohibited. Yet they do not stay away from something which has always been haram, never halal, in Ramadan, night, day, outside Ramadan, before Ramadan, after Ramadan, all your life they're haram. Now backbiting, a major sin. It's never been. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he say? He said, these two women, they fasted from those things which Allah has made halal for them. وَأَفْتَرَطَ عَمَّا حَرَّمُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمَا. But they never observed a fast from those things that Allah has made haram for them. جَلَسَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا إِلَى الْأُخْرَى. What did the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? One of them sat with the other. They both sat. جَلَسَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا إِلَى الْأُخْرَى تَأْكُلَانِ لُحُومَ النَّاسِ. They sat with one another all day long, eating the flesh of human beings. Because ghibah, that's what it is. They stayed away from halal food, from chicken, from halal meat, from water, but they were eating the flesh and sucking the blood of other human beings. And this is what Allah says in the Quran about ghibah. So in this month of Ramadan, we need to really ensure we abstain from fast. One of the Salaf 30 scholars, somebody, I can't remember, he said, As-sa'imu fi ibadatin ma lam yaghtar. A fasting person is always in ibadah and is always receiving the rewards as long as it does not backbite. وَإِنَّمَا عَلَى فِرَاشِهِ. Even though if he sleeps all day long. Just do your five times. I'm not saying just do that. Do if you can more. But if you think you're going to harm other people's feelings, hurt other people's feelings, you will end up backbiting, you will end up doing things that are not appropriate, then it's better just do your five time prayers, do your tarawih, fast and sleep all day long. As long, you know, sleep all day long. Because as long as you're avoiding yourself, and you're preventing yourself from committing haram. And there's a hadith, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, there's two, three hadiths, and I'll just mention these two, three hadiths, 3 minutes, and we'll end. There's a hadith, the hadith of Sahih al-Bukhari, where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ وَالْعَمَلَ بِهِ فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةٌ فِي أَنْ يَدَعَ طَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ. The one who does not abstain from قَوْلَ الزُّورِ, from what? From futile or from sinful or obscene, or zul literally means to say a lie, but it includes all sins of the tongue, basically. Whoever does not stay away from the sins of the tongue, lying, riba, backbiting, and acting upon these sins, فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةٌ. Allah is not in need of any of his leaving, Allah is not in need of him abstaining from food and drink. Allah doesn't need it. فليس لله حاجة في أن يضع طعام وشراب. ندى حديث كم من صائم رب من صائم كم من صائم. Both wordings have been mentioned. كم من صائم ليس له من صيامه إلا الجوع والعطش. How many people fast? They have nothing. They've not done nothing. The only thing they've done is they've stayed hungry and thirsty. No rewards. May Allah save us. وكم من قائم ليس له من قيامه إلا السهر. A lot of people who stay awake all night worshipping Allah, but they get nothing except just staying awake. Nothing. No rewards. There's a hadith as well where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this is the definition. Look at this hadith. لَيْسَ الصِّيَامُ مِنَ الطَّعَامِ وَالشَّرَابِ. I think this hadith is in Sahih of Imam Ibn Hibban. It's a Sahih hadith. لَيْسَ الصِّيَامُ مِنَ الطَّعَامِ وَالشَّرَابِ. إِنَّمَا الصِّيَامُ مِنَ اللَّغْوِ وَالرَّفَثِ. SubhanAllah. Amazing hadith. Fasting is not staying away from food and drink. That's an easy fast. Anyone does that. Real fasting is what? من اللغو الصيام من اللغو والرفث. Stay away from lagu, from futile activity, from slandering, rafath. إنما الصيام من اللغو والرفث. You know the word rafath. All, I tell you one thing, brothers and sisters. All these acts of ibadah and worship that we find us, we see all these acts of ibadah. The rewards of all these acts of ibadah are taken away. They vanish. They evaporate. They go away. When there's things like slandering, hurting people's feelings, argumentation, jidal, mira, all of it. I just had a talk, I was just in the north just last in Bolton on Monday, one of the masjids in Bolton, on the Laylatul Nisr in Sha'ban. We had a talk. I said that this hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says it's a hadith, even though the sanad may not be that strong, but there are many hadith, and it's not a talk, that topic that I can go into. But there's a night where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Laylatul Nisr min Sha'ban, in the Sunan of Imam al-Bayhaqi, that Allah frees thousands of people. يُعْتَقُ اللَّهُ فِيهَا مِنَ النَّارِ بِقَدْرِ شَعْرِ غَنَمِ بَنِكَ. To the amount of people that equals the hairs on the cattle and the sheep and goats owned by the tribe of Kalb, Banu Kalb. Meaning Allah forgives millions of people. But on that night when Allah forgives millions of people, Allah does not even look at the one إِلَى مُشَاحٍ وَلَا يَنْظُرُ اللَّهُ إِلَى مُشَاحٍ وَلَا إِلَى قَاطِعِ رَحِمٍ. Allah does not even look at the one who has hatred and enmity in the heart to other Muslims and other human beings. Allah does not even look at the one who breaks ties. There's a hadith, لَا يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةَ قَاطِعُ رَحِمٍ. The one who breaks ties shall not enter paradise. لَا يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةَ قَاطِعُ. All these acts of ibadah. Look at Hajj. You know Hajj, there are only a few verses in the Quran about Hajj. When Allah talks about Hajj, He says, الْحَجُّ أَشْهُرٌ مَعْلُومَاتٌ. Hajj is known, the months are known. فَمَنْ فَرَضَ فِيهِنَّ الْحَجَّ فَلَا رَفَثَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ وَلَا جِدَالَ فِي الْحَجِّ. I'm really ending, inshallah, concluding. But I'm just giving an example. We all go for Hajj. Allah doesn't tell us in the Quran, no details, do this, ibadah, that, arafah, muzdalifah, none of that. When Allah talks about Hajj in the Quran, what does He say? If you want, there's three conditions for accepted Hajj. This is in Surah Al-Baqarah. فَمَنْ فَرَضَ فِيهِنَّ الْحَجِّ فَلَا رَفَثَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ وَلَا جِدَالَ. If you want your Hajj to be accepted, you want to be a Haji Sahib who wants to be accepted Haji Sahib in the eyes of Allah. It's easy to go into, you know, Arafah and Muzdalifah. That's all easy. That's all easy. Fasting is easy. لَيْسَ الصِّيَامُ مِنَ الطَّعَامِ وَالشَّرَابِ. Observing from drink and food is easy. إِنَّمَا الصِّيَامُ real fasting, the Hadith I said of Ibn Hibban, من اللغو والرفث. Same word, رفث, mentioned in Hajj as well. Real fasting is to avoid sinful talk. And رفث, slandering, harming people. فَمَنْ فَرَضَ فِيهِ فَلَا رَفَثَ. Allah says, three conditions. If you want your Hajj to be accepted, no رفث, no فُسُوق. No sins. Here, the word رفث is to do sins that are of a sexual nature. And فُسُوق as well, any kind of sin. No sin. If there's a condition for your Hajj to be accepted, you observe, you protect your eyes from committing a sin. You protect your hands from committing a sin. You don't give someone a blow in Muzdalifah because they pushed you. You don't push someone with your hand. You don't go to the black stone and push. If you go to the black stone, Al-Hajar al-Aswad, and you want to kiss that stone, and you push someone, then rather than, you know, you're getting rewards, you come back with all the sins that are on the black stone. Really? Really? Because it's haram. In order to kiss the black stone, if we are pushing anyone, then it's absolutely sinful to kiss the black stone. So this is وَلَا رَفَثَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ. And then Allah says وَلَا جِدَالَ. What's jidal? No argumentation, no quarreling, no dispute in Hajj. Hajj is not the time for argumentation. Hajj is not the time. Hajj is to strive and struggle. It's difficult. That's why you do Hajj. You don't want to be all cozy, that's not a Hajj. If you argue in Hajj, Hajj is not accepted. If you argue in fast is not accepted, no rewards. If you argue and fight and quarrel whilst coming to the masjid for Taraweeh, no rewards for Taraweeh. If you argue with all these ibadat, no rewards will be gained. So to wrap up, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the tawfiq to act upon some of these things that I've mentioned. This is a reminder for myself first and foremost, and then to all of you. We need to always remember that we should worship Allah, do whatever we can do to the best of our ability, but we should try first and foremost to stay away from sins, first and foremost to ensure that we don't harm any human being, and even animals. We should not do anything that contributes to harming anyone in any shape or form. And if we, in this month of Ramadan, if we observe our fast like that, if we spend the whole month of Ramadan in a way that we've not hurt anybody's feelings, parents, spouses, children, brothers, sisters, co-workers, at least try for 1 month. This month I will be just completely passive. I'm not saying you should, in your life you'll be absolutely passive all the time, but at least to start off, I will be absolutely passive. That's why the hadith, last hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إذا كان يوم صوم أحدكم فلا يرفث ولا يسخر. Again, when one of you is fasting, don't yell, don't slander. فإن سابه أحد أو قاتله فليقل إني امرؤ صائم. If someone swears at you, someone slanders you, then say, you know what, brother, إني امرؤ صائم, in a nice way, I'm fasting, sorry, I can't help you. This is a hadith. وَإِن جَهِلَ عَلَىٰ أَحَدِكُمْ جَاهِلٌ. If you're provoked by a jahil, someone's trying to provoke you to get you into an argument. He's intentionally driving like that so that he wants you to get heated. Some people like arguments, you know, they thrive on it. They just can't live a life without, you know, arguing with someone. So he wants an argument. فَلْيَقُلِ إِنِّي امْرُؤٌ صَائِمٌ. Just say, you know what, I'm fasting. I'm in the middle of Ramadan. I don't want any of this. This is a hadith, these are all sound hadiths of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So at least 1 month, if we can spend in a way we don't harm anyone, no backbiting, no tail bearing, no hurting feelings with anyone, and inshallah in this way, then this will enable us to be like that even after Ramadan.